start off today by just having a special welcome for a couple of people. You know, two guys who I spoke to as they came in were Ronnie Lachlan over here and Merv. And do you know these guys, the elder statesmen of our church, are both 92 years old and both sitting here. I did say to them, I wish my IQ was 92, let alone my age. But, you know, we want you guys to know that we really appreciate you. I remember coming to Charlestown, which I did some 30 years ago. You know, these guys were in their 60s then, and were really guys I've admired over the years. So good to see you guys hanging in there. Also, a little special welcome to Stratos and Ruth and family. Stratos and Ruth are from our friends. Strato is one of the great guys of the world because he flies a paraglider, and they're visiting with us today, so welcome. You know, today I want to talk about life. Life. Now, back in the 80s, there was this whole thing, you know, life being it. Remember this? Put up your hand if you remember this. Okay, we have an aged group in our church here. I mean, it was all about getting Norm out there, wasn't it, and sort of embracing life and just being part of it, not sitting on the couch the whole time. I mean, for most of us, when we think about our lives, I suppose we have this idea that one day we'll meet someone, get married, have some kids, get a house, and you sort of have this sort of plan what your life might be like. But the reality is it doesn't always work out as neatly for everyone. And what I find is that these days, when I love this sort of map of the underground, because what it does is this is Stephanie mapping out her life, and it just seems to me if I was to describe the university student of today that I interact with, I'd use the word multitasking. You know, they just have so many aspects of their life that sort of go along in parallel here and all interweave, and I tell you, it gets complex. But the people who really got my attention this week, whose lives are really complex, are these guys. Now, you know, given the pervasive nature of the media, I think most of us caught up with the fact that there were just quite literally thousands of people fleeing Syria and heading out in Hungary, trying to make their way through that country to Germany, who said they would take them. And I must admit, when you just go and Google, as I did last night, the Syrian conflict, trying to get your head around what's actually going on over there, I mean, that is just one heck of a conflict. Man. I mean, it started off as part of the Arab spring uprising, but now it's become such a complicated battle by the time you put fundamentalist groups in there and ISIS and everything else and man alive. They are in 5 years into a civil war that seems to have no end. And when you look at the toll currently of a country that's got like 26 million people, currently there's about 4 million of them just living in camps like this, displaced from their homes. And you know, when you look at all these refugees who are trying to get asylum, you know, I just saw on the net there this comment, you know, why don't they just go home? Well, you know, for them, home looks like this. You know, home in Syria. Streets that used to walk through, families that used to sort of picnic together. You know, the trauma that these guys are going through at the moment. And for most of us, we're very moved with the image of that little kid's body on the beach there in Greece. And you know, your heart goes out to the father. Because when that boat sank, he lost his wife and all his kids. Now, it's very easy for us in this church on a Saturday morning in Newcastle, where our lives are all so great, to just sort of say, man, that must be difficult for them. But have we got any idea what it must be like? Do we really have any idea? I mean, empathy is a powerful thing. It's a powerful thing. But man, I mean, what do those guys hang on to? Like that guy who's lost his whole family, he's fleeing a war zone where he no longer has property or a house. I mean, what does he actually hold on to in that sort of time when just everything about his life is just basically destructed around him? You know, for some of us, I started thinking then, you know, what's the sort of worst thing that happens to us in Australia? I mean, we don't have various people shooting at us. We've lost the ashes, Bob's saying. I mean, the fact is, for a lot of people in Australia, I suppose, there's life can hit a fairly major hurdle when, you know, you become unemployed or you lose your job. You know, that can be reasonably traumatic. You can sort of think, oh, no, what am I going to do? You know, particularly if you don't sort of have a plan B, you know, that can be a very troubling time. Or, you know, for a lot of us, life hits a fairly major speed bump when you sort of get sick. And for, you know, some people getting sick, you can get really sick. And man, I mean, I went to a celebration last week at the University of Newcastle of Professor Sid Burke, who, you know, Debbie's been nursing in hospital, but that guy's in palliative care now, weeks to live with bowel cancer, and he's been just a giant in my life. He was my PhD supervisor, and to see him just like a stick insect, man. I mean, what does he hold on to? Well, you know, for some of us, you know, you have an accident. And let's face it, some of these things can be catastrophic. I mean, I love this image. I mean, that guy just got towed onto that wave with that jet ski, and then he's got issues. But, you know, some people, they just go and put themselves in harm's way. I'll tell you, these guys are just crazy, these downhill skateboard riders. Have you seen them do this? I mean, get a load of this guy. Fearlessly they lay down their lives. Son, don't be afraid to die. You're fighting for the land that you love. When we first pushed in, it was great. I was flying. I wasn't thinking of anything. Then the first corner comes and, you know, reality kind of hits and you kind of double check yourself on what you're doing, and I made the wrong decision. Oh, there was definitely a moment of just nothingness. Did I make it?
How you feel? Okay.
And then all the pain sets in. And you realize you're still there. I've hit the ground pretty hard. I've broke bones, but I've never hit a non-moving object as hard as I hit that guardrail.
Are you gonna skate more?
Yeah.
You gonna skate right now?
Every minute. Go to the top and lay down.
So it turns out he's got 3 fractured vertebrae from hitting that fence. Spent the next 2 months in a neck brace. You know, would you do that?
Yep.
I must admit, it looks pretty exciting. The fact is, for all of us, you know, we can... You think life's going to be good, and suddenly, within an instant, it's different. And how do you cope? I mean, that guy's looking for an adrenaline buzz, and then suddenly he's got a... You know, luckily for him, his spinal cord wasn't damaged, and he was sort of able to continue to function. Well, you know, for some people, the trauma's associated with relationship breakups. I mean, we know they happen. We know they happen. And you sort of have this nice, ideal idea of mum, dad and the kids, and suddenly it's all being ripped apart. You know, I just love this. You know, Facebook gives you some great things, doesn't it? On my feed, they've got notes that your partner leaves when they're leaving. You know, I just love this one. It said, I know you can't read, I'll read it to you. Brenda, I've got my eye, Brenda. Brenda, this isn't working. You know it, I know it, I moved out. Goodbye, Mark. P.S. I took the dog. He hates you. I mean, imagine coming home to that on the fridge. But no matter which way you look at it, a relationship breakdown, mate, that can be just traumatic. You know, now Bob's got a bit of a tradition of playing a song when he preaches at Charlestown, so I thought, you know, you're my inspiration, Bob, so I thought I'd better find some sort of song. I did check out the Heritage Singers and All Your Ilk, Bob, but the one I've got is actually from Birds of Tokyo. Now, if you don't know Birds of Tokyo, here they are. But they've got this song, and I've actually picked the clip where the words are on it. I just want you to listen to the words. Mm-hmm.
much too late to try. You're never coming home. When the tide came in, you left without a sound. We don't say what we should say. We get lost beyond the answer. We find loneliness. We pretend, but in the end, we get lost beyond the answer. We find loneliness.
This guy, his relationship's breaking up, and basically his partner is just sort of ebbing away. That's a challenge for the way Bob to play a song from 2015. What happens is that his relationship's breaking up. It's his partner's just moved away, and he says that, you know, I never thought to hold you. I never thought that you might need an anchor. I never thought I'd lose you. I never thought that you might need an anchor. And somehow he's saying, if I just recognised it earlier, I could have actually held you close. I could have tried to give something to anchor our relationship on, but instead you've drifted off. You know, and that song really got me thinking about anchors, because I thought, you know, anchors are just substantive things. They're things that can just hold big, big boats in place in huge storms. And if I put these two ideas together as I'm thinking of different life events, I think, you know, what is it that's our anchors? When those things like loss of job or sickness or relationship breakdowns or war events, like when those things hit us, in those moments of absolute craziness, what do we hang on to? What are our anchors? See, you watch the ABC, I know I'm aging because I find myself watching the ABC more and more, which is something I hate when my dad used to do that. You know Todd Sampson? So Todd Sampson's had a great series on the ABC called Redesign My Brain. And what Todd decided to do is that he did all sorts of training and looked at brain-changing techniques, because he set himself a challenge, and that challenge to walk on a tightrope between the two towers of the University of Technology, Sydney. And, you know, I regularly go to that place. That's where we have our New South Wales Council of Dean meetings. And, man, on the top floor, it's 21 stories. And when you look, it is a long way down. So he did all sorts of things. He taught himself to put up with more pain. He taught himself to stay calm under pressure using mindfulness techniques. He did all sorts of training to prepare for the event. And after these three episodes, which you can probably still watch them on iView, I highly recommend them, he then said, right, let's give it a go.
All right, let's take this down and prepare to cross.
He's decided he's going to do it without the safety rope up the top.
Todd wants to get clean skin. His heart's really set on doing it the way the experts will do it. As the safety guy, that makes my heart jump into my mouth, because he has one safety line, one attachment to the rope, that's it. And if any of those things break or compromised, it's over, Red Rover.
It's a massive thing he's about to do with a very, you know, limited time of training. And that's a lot of pressure.
So I made a decision that I would do it on tether only, no top line for safety. I know a lot of people weren't happy with that decision, but if I'm going to spend all this time training, I want to do it for real.
Everybody settle.
Here goes. 21 floors up, 8 meters across a cable, only 3 centimeters wide. But have I conquered my fear enough to step off this building?
Keep your arms up, arms.
So now he's hanging. Now, right now at that point, would you want to make sure that, you know, you had a firm grip? I mean, that is seriously scary. That guy, he'd never been on tightrope before, by the way, and part of the series was trying to learn how to do that. You know, I just think it's a metaphor, though. So many people can just find themselves quite literally in life just hanging on by their fingertips and saying, you know, gee, what am I going to do now? I'd like to put it to you, I actually believe that life is always going to throw punches at us, and that you're much better off, rather than being reactive to situations, proactively think, when trouble comes my way, what strategies am I going to have to deal with it? See, I think for us, Viktor Frankl, he wrote that tremendous book which I've mentioned before in a previous sermon about man's search for meaning. Viktor Frankl was in German prisoner of war camps during World War II. And what Viktor Frankl, one of the conclusions he drew in his book, this, he said, he concludes from his experience that a prisoner's psychological reactions are not solely the result of the conditions of his life, but also from the freedom of choice he always has, even in severe suffering. The inner hold a prisoner has on his spiritual self relies on having a hope in the future, and that once a prisoner loses hope, he is doomed. What Frankl said is, despite our circumstances, all of us have a choice to make. And in his experience in those camps, he was a medical doctor, by the way, and he noted so many things about the people he said, you have the choice, and those people who chose hope lived. The minute you lost hope for the future and hope in your circumstance, his fellow prisoner of war, they died within days. So I would say that a chief strategy for us is that if we want to be able to survive what life throws at us, we ought to have in our life a decent sense of hope. Hope. Hope for the future. But you know what many of us do? Many of my friends in Newcastle, I'll tell you, they say, I want hope for the future. I am going to make my life better. Me. I am going to do it. You know Todd Sampson, he got back on that high wire after, you know, they wheeled him in and he said, I'm going again. Remember, he's trained. He said, I can do this, I can do this. So he trained and trained and trained. So, you know, let's see if he makes it this time.
At least I'm okay and I'm going to go again. I'm not going to let the fear overcome me. I'm just going to go straight away. As Melinda said, never give up, so I'm not giving up.
It's all in the power of the mind to overcome those fears.
Despite feeling the way that you're feeling, you're choosing courageous action.
When you have control of your mind, you have control over your life.
Why is he crying? You know what? Talk about under stress. I mean, that guy decides he's going to walk across that tightrope and he is going to train himself to do it. And I tell you what, he was under a huge amount of stress because he tried doing it once and he'd failed and he was going to do it again. But what if I can't do it? He had all this sort of self-doubt. He said, And when he made it, there was such an emotional outpouring of relief. He actually goes on to say, it's over. And you know the trouble with that is that many people think that they're going to make their lives better and they're going to give themselves hope by making a better tomorrow for themselves, by becoming educated and getting good jobs and working harder and striving harder. And I will tell you what, at the end of the day, it's just this pile of stress. This pile of stress. I mean, what's our anchor? What is your hope? I think when I look around at the audience here, I know that each of us has a particular worldview. I mean, our worldview is very much a collection of sort of intellectual or emotional or spiritual grids or paradigms that have developed through conscious and unconscious acceptance or rejection of concepts or beliefs. You know, we've had a lot of structure in our lives and a lot of experiences, and from that, we start working out what works for us and what doesn't, what we accept and what we don't. And from that, these things, our worldview forms a filter system through which the separate data of reality are processed and organized by individuals. You know, we have answers to questions like how we got here, you know, why we are here, what's going on, what will happen in the future. All of these things we answer based on our worldview, which is a set of beliefs that we've acquired through our lifetime. What I can tell you is that our worldviews, which all of us have, they are the secret to hope. They are the secret. These worldviews actually give us the bigger picture sense of what's going on, and they give us a context in which we can live our lives even when terrible things are happening. But what's interesting is that if I showed you this list of things, which things up there have been pivotal in influencing your worldview? And if I ask you to arrange them in a particular order, this is a research study, and here's three people. The first person arranged them like that, the second person arranged them like that, and the third person like this. Now, it's interesting to me that this person here with family, culture, church, Bible, and notice down here, Bible, church, Bible down the bottom, this person would actually, their worldview, as I would put to you, is quite different to these two in terms of their explanation of what's going on. So which is, in actual fact, the correct order? You know, sometimes this bigger picture idea of us sorting it out, what's going on in the world and what's actually happening, gives us this context which actually becomes the anchor in our life. So we went to Bali flying paragliders. You can't have a church story without a paragliding story, a church sermon without a paragliding story. So this is me. Kendall. Bogdan. Henry, Joseph, Strato, and the latest member of the Charlestown Church Paragliding Club is Greg, who's just got back this morning. You know, we went over there. Did you know, by the way, I've worked out this morning that about 10% of the Newcastle Paragliding Club comes to this church? It's an amazing thing. You know, we went over there and had a pretty good time, I must admit. I mean, flying a paraglider is a pretty good time. We also had some times that, you know, weren't quite as good. You know, this is me stuffing up a launch. This is Kendall just having dropped it in the trees when he landed. But one of the things we wanted to do is fly on these Bali cliffs. Now, the Bali cliffs are incredible. They are quite high and they go down. We're at the very bottom of Bali at Nusa Dua, and these cliffs go off into the future. So we decided we'd accept the challenge to go down there. And so we went through. So there's a picture that Bogdan took of myself flying along those cliffs. The trouble is you get a bit addicted to it, and after a while you just want to keep going and going and going and going. Now when I look at the satellite view of Bali, we actually were taking off over here, and that picture I just showed you is actually that part there. Can you see those three little things sticking out? So that's them there, right? So here is where those cliffs were. Now what happens is that when you're flying a paraglider, the clothesline actually looks quite straight. And we sort of thought, okay, we could just go here forever. But if you actually observe the bigger picture of the island of Bali, when you zoom out a little bit, you actually soon realize that the bottom of Bali is not particularly straight, it's curved. And that the wind direction for us was predominantly coming for this way. And as we're down here flying along, so we took off and we're flying along here, you actually get to the point where as this coastline keeps wrapping around, that when you turn around to come back, you end up having to fly directly into wind. And if the wind's too strong, you can't go anywhere, and so you go down. So without sort of this bigger picture in mind and full of bravado and without having really asked anyone, we all set off. So Kendall, on that flight, where did you land? So Kendall decided he would like to go all the way back to this point here, and then it turned out the rest of us turned around about here, but as he got to that point, when he turned around, straight into the headwind. And so he did the only thing he could do, made a very quick decision, which is good, and landed on the top of the cliff, so he didn't have to get in the water, and then had a real adventure, getting his glider out of the tree, walking kilometres to the road, hitchhiking back to the hotel. It was all part of the fun. When we're talking about that night, we actually got from the instructor, Dave, boy, you guys, what are you doing way down there? You shouldn't have gone past this point. What are you doing down there? And we said, well, no one told us. He said, don't you know the bottom of Bali, it's curved, it's not flat. You go down there, you get into real trouble. People have died in that spot. And we're going, well, nobody told us. But the fact is, is it the lack of the bigger picture? Is it our stupidity or is it our circumstance? Lloyd's running with stupidity. See, what happens, the bigger picture is incredible. And what I can tell you, in our instances, we each have a bigger picture in our lives. I mean, we all have the story of our lives, our own individual story, but sitting above this story is usually our family's story that very much impacts our life story. But sitting above that story is our Australian story. Now, whether you came from another country or whatever, you're here with us at the moment and you're now part of the Australian journey, and yet the Australian story is impacted by the sort of international stories that are going on. And these things are in turn impacted by the earth story, which is in turn impacted by the God story. I mean, all of these layers filters down to impact our story. I mean, it's very interesting going and looking into levels above your story. I know for myself, I've never really been much into the family history. I didn't really care about it that much. But I must admit, I found myself in England. Then I found out there was a town called Beamish in York. So I went there, actually found out that my ancestors were brewers of the highest order. And actually, the family moved from Ireland to Northern England way back when. And the one thing our family's particularly good at is making beer. Who would have thought? Our family stories are incredibly interesting. All of my brothers and sisters are fair, blonder hair, fairer skin, whereas I have darker hair, or used to be dark anyway, and more olive skin. And we actually found out that when we looked into my mum's side of the family, that the family tree just stopped after my grandparents. And we found out my great-grandfather, whose name was Jack Washington, and he actually moved from England to New Zealand and changed his name to Herbert. And when he was 91 years old, on his deathbed, he called the family together because he said, I want to tell you the story of why I left England. And as he started telling that story, he died of a heart attack. So what we do know is that he was part of aristocracy in England and was part of a huge scandal, which led him to fled. And that's where I've got to in my investigations. What sort of scandal? Now, our family stories are very interesting, but what I want to talk to this morning is an actual fact. As we go up through these, on top of it all is this God story. If we want to know where our anchors are, where our hope is, surely as we travel up through those layers, that God story that sort of overrides everything is the pivotal story to be aware of. See, the God story gives us a sense of beginning. We know why we're here, because God put us here. And God didn't put us here. You know, I've heard God was lonely. He wanted someone to interact with. God was completely self-fulfilled. But what God wanted to do was share. So our world came around. The God story is full of God interacting with humanity and sending messages to us through his people and his prophets. The God story maps out our future and the fact that this world one day will be restored, as books like Revelation tell us, and that there is a future for us. I mean, that's the God story. The trouble we have with the God story is that for a lot of us, though, it just seems the God story seems to have happened so long ago. I mean, I'm here, but the God story, it was back then. And when you see pictures of Jesus, like I just Googled Jesus this morning, there it is. You know, I tried to find a picture of Jesus wearing anything but a robe, and I couldn't. Because what we do is that we actually put, when God came to earth, when Jesus was here, he was living in a particular time, and that is the ongoing representation of him is looking like that. But what I do know is that Jesus is ever present now as he was back then, but in my head, I picture him back then. Do I picture him now? I mean, the God story is full of the greats like Abraham, like Moses, like Gideon, like Elijah on Mount Carmel, like Joshua and Caleb, like Daniel. I mean, these stories that we grew up with as kids, many of these stories, God is using these people to reveal what he's like or to give directions. Do this. When I look at these pictures, I see God is not a being that's just sort of disconnected from the world, but regularly sending messages down to the world. He's sending messages down through these prophets, down to my level of the story, trying to give me help and direction about where I should be going. And sometimes we sort of think, oh, geez, those guys back in the Old Testament, it was so difficult back then. But look at the messages. I mean, look at the messages God gave through his prophets. If you actually look there in Ezekiel, I have no pleasure in the death of the one who dies, says the Lord God. Therefore, turn and live. I mean, his exhortation to those people at the time saying, guys, I want you to survive. You're taking yourselves down the wrong path. Wise up. Or messages like we see in Jeremiah, for I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not evil, to give you a future and a hope. We look there in Isaiah, he will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces. And back to Jeremiah, then shall the virgin rejoice in the dance, and the young men and the old together, for I will return their mourning to joy. I will turn their mourning to joy. Will comfort them and make them rejoice rather than sorrow. I mean, these messages that came down from the God level down to where we are in our story are messages of hope. They are messages of connection. They tell us that God wants the best for us. They're incredible. And we sort of petition it back and say, yeah, but it all happened so long ago. But you know what? This is an insight into a God who wants the very same thing for us today. The very same thing. And that's why those stories are so incredible, because they in action an internal being. I mean, the whole God story was no better revealed than through Jesus himself. Jesus who came down to this world and sort of met with humanity and interacted. Jesus who told stories like in Luke 15 of the prodigal son, who shuns his father, says, give me my money, I want to go. And the prodigal son leaves and wastes it all and finds himself eating with pigs and then thinking, you know, even my servants in my father's house are treated better than this. And so as he goes home, it's the story of the Father, seeing him coming and running down the road to embrace him. And why did Jesus tell that story? Because what he's trying to do is connect the God story with our story and say, that's what God is like. That is what God is like. You know, if you're hitting those rough patches, the whole idea that there is an internal being who cares about you and can comfort you and support you and give you hope for the future is a very empowering thing. In Hebrews we find, we who have run for our very lives to God have every reason to grab the promised hope with both hands and never let go. It's an unbreakable spiritual lifeline, reaching past all appearances right to the very presence of God, where Jesus, running on ahead of us, has taken up his permanent post as high priest for us. Wow. Wow. Right now, God wants to influence our story so much that Jesus is sitting on the right hand of God, as the Bible says, interceding on our behalf, reminding God we're here, looking after our interests. So for me, when I'm looking for anchors, I want to tell you, I think the anchor that we can have when life gets rough is that top ongoing God story. It gives us that context. It gives us the hope. It gives us explanation, and it can be incredibly empowering. You know those Syrians, they're fleeing. Finally, Hungary relented and put some buses on, didn't they, to Austria? Then they provided some trains. You just imagine how it feels walking out of that station and have all those Austrians there to greet you when your life's been so hard.
People applauding the refugees as they arrive. They're here, this is their final destination. Ordinary German men and women stood here and applauding them. This is, of course, the end of a very, very long journey for them. Extraordinary scenes, extraordinary. People handing them water. Welcome to Germany. How do you feel? Thumbs up. And there's a little boy here handing out sweets to children. Look at these smiles.
You know, do you think that those Syrians were happy to be there? You know, to be surrounded by people who said, you know what, we don't care about the protocols at the moment, we're opening our country to you, and the Germans to turn around and say, we will take 1 million of you. You know, thank God our Prime Minister finally came to his senses. You know, Australia's committed to 12,000, drop in the ocean. Did you know half of the Syrians are going to be displaced in this war? My goodness, look at the country we've got. We could just about take them all. The fact is, though, that those guys under such duress, when they come to a place which is a foreign home to them and receive such welcome, man, that the stress abates and they say, you know what, this mightn't be our home, but boy, are we happy to be here. The thing that gives me hope, the thing that anchors me in the time, is the God story. Because what the God story does, it tells me why I'm here. It gives me an explanation of what's going on. It provides an explanation of what God's like and gives me hope for a future. And I tell you what else could we ask for? What else do we need? When you think that through the death of Jesus Christ on the cross, we can have it all. We can have it all. Incredible.